showed up in record numbers to watch the Vol play. The players who bear the brunt of the season in so far as work and effort and sacrifice is concerned are quality people too. We are indeed proud of our people in arms.
People, players, coaches, fans in the stands, fans at home. Wherever they get involved, football is people. The people who play, the members of the University of Tennessee team, are both individuals with individual skills and members of a team working together to maintain the tradition of football, which is such an inherent part of the way of life Tennesseans enjoy throughout the state and country. In 1975, people in Orange felt the importance of Tennessee football to their lives. People in Orange in 1975 were exciting. It was a season of big plays on offense and defense, like the running of Stanley Morgan, record-breaking rusher, the jarring tackles of linebacker Andy Spiva, the emergence of young runners, Fox and Finch, Pookie and Emmons, all four freshmen. The play in the defensive secondary of Mike Moss, the punt returns of Morgan, and there was Siebers, the receiver, All-American record-setting split end. Good things happened in 1975 because of people like these, and everyone mentioned will be back in 1976. People in Orange, young in 75, this is their story. The people in Orange were young. Very young in the skill positions. In the offensive line, often overlooked by fans who follow the ball, was a group which had its moments of success as it progressed during the year. In the Kentucky game at Lexington, a pulling offensive guard, Joe Gallagher, number 78, makes a perfect block to open the hole for Stanley Morgan to break free and race 80 yards for the touchdown. David Brady, a junior from Merritt Island, Florida, rated as UT's most consistent lineman in 75. Should have an outstanding 1976. Here is Brady, number 59, opening the hole for Morgan's run. Freshman fullback Craig Pookie also matured as a blocker, as shown in this play. Offensive line were the running backs in orange. Basically, a young group, like juniors Mike Gales and Stanley Morgan. Morgan, all SEC in 74 as a sophomore, missed much of the season with an injured ankle, sprained in the Vols' win over LSU. He never regained full speed until the last game of the season at Hawaii. But in that game, the junior from Easley, South Carolina, set a new UT single-game rushing record of 204 yards. Morgan started the season brilliantly. Here, he returns a punt 70 yards against Maryland in the opening game of the year. With everyone physically well, Tennessee defeated Maryland 26-8. The Terps came back from this loss to win the ACC, finish in the top 10, and defeat Florida in the Gator Bowl. Morgan amassed 306 yards rushing in the first three games. Then came the injured ankle against LSU, and the Vol offense missed him. Another junior tailback, Mike Gales, number 43, started the season alternating with Morgan. Gales had his moments, such as in this 33-yard run against North Texas. Here, Gales is a key figure in the deceptive Utah pass play against LSU for a Vol touchdown to seal the SEC victory over the Tigers. Tennessee uses several running backs in its offensive scheme, like Frank Fox, number 24, who had a three-touchdown day against Utah. Kelsey Finch, number 36, who played both fullback and tailback. Fullback Bobby Emmons, number 32, from Fayetteville, Tennessee, was impressive in several games. Craig Pookie, impressive both as a runner and blocker. The people at Orange who run with the ball foretell an exciting 1976 for UT fans. People in orange who catch the ball played a key role in the excitement of 1975. Tommy West, John Yarbrough, Tim Fitzpatrick, freshman Jeff Moore, and All-American Larry Sievers, who will be back in 1976. Sievers, who caught 41 passes for 840 yards, is a highlights film in himself. Watch a catch-by-catch synopsis against Auburn by Sievers, the junior from Clinton, Tennessee. Like Stanley Morgan, was injured and missed one game and was below speed at Fremore. Freshman Jeff Moore from Memphis showed great promise as a receiver with speed and good hands, as this catch against Kentucky shows. These are the men who threw the ball in 1975. Randy Wallace, a junior quarterback, led the Southeastern Conference in passing. Thank you. coach, number 5, a sophomore, throwing here to John Behrens. They will be joined in 76 by Pat Ryan, a junior who sat out the season with injuries, and promising sophomores-to-be and incoming freshman prospects as the Vols prepare for 1976. On defense, the people in orange are divided into 3 categories: front four, linebackers, defensive secondary. Again, the people in orange are basically young, although seniors played key roles in the Vol defensive scheme of things. Defensive end Ron McCartney, number 57, was selected captain of the 1975 team in midseason. McCartney was a model of consistency. This sack of the opposing quarterback was typical of the play of the senior from Charleston, West Virginia. So imposing a force was McCartney that many teams ran away from his side whenever possible. Senior tackle David Page, number 72, from Nashville, used intelligence and technique to play consistently throughout his career. And his play at Kentucky was one of the outstanding performances of any Vol tackle during the past decade. 2 members of the front four, end Kevin Davis, number 39, and tackle Jim Woofter, number 71, are juniors and return in 76. They'll be joined by an exciting group of rising sophomores, including 250-pound Brad Watts and 6'5 Glenn Tucker, tackles, and defensive end Mike Klarman. The upfront people in orange are bigger and stronger and should give the Vols strength defensively. Tennessee's linebackers have long been the keystone of the defense, stemming from the days of Frank Emanuel, Paul Newmoff, Steve Kiner, Jackie Walker, Jack Reynolds, Ray Nettles, Jamie Rotella, and the latest All-Star candidates, headed by junior Andy Spiva and sophomore Russ Williams. Spiva made big play after big play, like in this stop against LSU. Sophomore Russ Williams, number 47, from Cincinnati, was Tennessee's most consistent defensive performer in 1975. Williams hits a jolting blow, as demonstrated in this play against Colorado State. Middle linebacker Greg Jones, number 53, also a sophomore, from Bristol, Tennessee, hits hard, has strength, and is a tough competitor. Senior Steve Poole departs, but back with the other 3 will be freshmen like Rick Powers and Dennis Wolfe, and juniors Kim Logan, Lionel Stewart, and Steve White. The people in orange who back the line are many and talented, and should definitely be stronger in 1976. Nowhere is the pressure greater than on the defensive backfield, and Tennessee's people in orange include key players who return in 76. Free safety Mike Moss, like Severs and Morgan, plagued with injuries in 1975, still was one of the leading tacklers on the team and won All-Star recognition for plays like this interception against Rose Bowl champion UCLA. Seniors Russ Ravenstein, Bill Cole, and Ernie Ward had high moments in 75, as did the younger backs, who included David Parsons, freshman Billy Arbo, sophomore Eddie Powers, who made 2 interceptions against Colorado State. Powers is from Clarksville, Tennessee. So the people in orange on defense were young, yet exciting, and made big play after big play during the season. The year started with an untried kicking game. Sophomore place kicker Jimmy Gaylor contributed to the season, as did sophomore punter Craig Colquitt, shown here in a punt against Alabama. Then the swift and stylish Stanley Morgan made the punt return a lethal weapon, so long as he was physically well. His punt returns time after time brought the people in orange to their feet, and the opposition soon decided to punt out of bounds rather than risk letting the junior speedster get his hands on the ball.
I'm confident about the potential of our offense in 1976. Our running backs should be better than they've been in the past few years, headed up by Stanley Morgan and Mike Gales and several young backs who played a great deal toward the end of the season. Our receivers should be, again, a quality group headed up by Larry Sievers, possibly the premier receiver in the country. Our offensive line only lost one starter, and we have some key freshmen who are coming up to provide competition there. There will be quite a battle at the quarterback spot in that we lost no quarterbacks to graduation. We lost some key defensive players and some people who were really outstanding leaders for our 1975 team, but I am excited about the potential of our defense next year. Our front four is better in terms of size and potential than any we've had. All three linebackers return. Mike Mauch and David Parsons return in the secondary, and our secondary could be crucial in terms of its progress, could determine the key to the success of our overall defensive team. 1976 will feature the best senior class in terms of numbers of quality players that we have had in the last 5 years. How well our young players do, including some key freshmen that will be coming in the fall, will determine the success of this 1976 football team.
The people in orange, important in 1975. People in orange on the field. People in orange in the stands, setting a new season's record for home attendance.
Welcome back to Tennessee Football Classics Vintage Orange, the 1975 Tennessee Volunteers. Tennessee finished the season 6-5 overall. Disappointing, but injuries had a lot to do with that. But Tennessee had one last game to play in that 1975 season, a scheduled trip to Hawaii. During those days, you were allowed to schedule that extra game if you went to Hawaii, and Tennessee tried to come back with a victory. As it turns out, Stanley Morgan had one of the greatest games in Tennessee football history.
Football fans, work is going on night and day to get ready for the 76 football season in Neyland Stadium. But somehow, I just can't forget that trip to Hawaii. Our team has made many trips. We've been to many bowl games. But the players, the coaches, and the fans, and the big orange clubs, and the thousands of people from Tennessee and surrounding states that went to Hawaii participated in the greatest trip Tennessee ever had. I just can't forget that trip to Hawaii.
Almost 8,000 fans accompanied a team on its trip to Hawaii, a holiday for which most had been saving for 4 years. Again, underscoring the importance of UT football to the enjoyment of life of thousands of Tennesseans.
Unusual sights ever seen on the beach at Waikiki was the big orange football team en masse taking hula lessons from a former Miss Hawaii. It was a day to remember.
Well, I don't know. I guess the main secret, I guess, is watching that teacher we had. Miss Hawaii was really super, and when she got her hips going, it was just kind of concentrating on what she was doing and following in. It was sort of like doing a dance, like a funky chicken or something to me. I just thought it was the same thing.
Was it fun? Were you kind of nervous out there doing that with all those people watching?
Well, at first I was kind of nervous, but then I started concentrating on the situation at hand, and it wasn't bad at all.
Did you ever in your wildest imagination think that one day you'd be doing the hula with the University of Tennessee football team?
Heck no. I can't believe it. It's tremendous. I just came on a flight over from Dallas, and somebody said he came all the way from Washington, D.C. just to see Tennessee play because it was his favorite team. And I said, oh, really? They're playing Saturday, and looks like they might win. But I never thought, you know, all this talk about Tennessee, that I'd actually meet the team. So that's really fantastic.
The action took place on Waikiki Beach. One of the favorite team pastimes was to rent a car and travel around the island of Oahu. Lots of them went to the beaches on the northern side of the island where the body surfing was great.
To the people who are watching exactly what we're doing today.
Okay, we're trying to body surf out here. This is Makapu Beach on the leeward side of the island. And what the trick is to catch the wave at the top of the crest, and instead of riding it straight down, you try to ride it either to left or right to try and catch the curl. That way you get a longer ride.
This is a real popular sport here in Hawaii, isn't it?
Yeah, this place right here, they don't allow surfboards for stags.
Okay, come here, Larry. You've been out doing this today. What does it feel like?
He just turned me completely upside down. I hit Phillips, Phillips hit Leroy. We all ended up in a big knot on the show. I can't believe how powerful these
things. It's a lot of fun, though, isn't it?
Whoa.
And here's the girl that rode one wave and quit for the day.
I about drowned.
It is a lot of fun, though, isn't it?
This is great. This is fantastic.
Okay. Hey, get rid of those Coca-Colas over there, and everybody, come on, let's go on in now. Go on in. Leave it on, Jerry.
Talk about something that'll wear you out. Try body surfing in Hawaii for a day. Tennessee supporters, close to 10,000 of them, traveled to Hawaii.
Where are y'all from?
Knoxville, Tennessee, home of the Vols.
This is kind of a new place for Big Orange Country to be out here on the beach of Waikiki, isn't it?
It sure is, but we're enjoying it.
Have you seen a lot of your friends since you've gotten over here?
We have seen lots of people.
Half an office here.
What?
Half of Knoxville's here, I think.
It's a lot of fun, isn't it?
It really is. We're having a real good time, we sure.
When people talk about the Big Orange and the tradition and all of that, this is kind of what it's all about, too, isn't it?
It sure is. We're here supporting them all the way.
We're Mr. and Ms. Jim Rippey from Union City, Tennessee.
And you're here for the game.
Right. Big Orange.
Are you all true Big Orange supporters?
Definitely. We drive to Knoxville quite often. We have season tickets.
Now, where are you all from?
We're from Knoxville.
Well, that's quite a trip from Knoxville to Honolulu.
Yeah, it's a pretty long trip for hillbillies to make.
Some of the players thought they'd try their luck at scuba diving and snorkeling, like Tommy West and Steve Poole.
What have y'all been doing today?
We've been snorkeling for about the past 2 hours.
What did you find when you went down there?
Fish are unbelievable, I can tell you. All the colors.
Had y'all done any snorkeling before?
First time I ever tried it.
What made you decide to do it?
We just decided to come out here and try it today because a lot of people on the island have been talking about it, and it's great because you see fish, you see in tanks all over in the United States, you know, and they're just right where it's 2 feet deep here. It's great.
Was it fun?
I loved it. We're going to come back in the morning.
Did you see any sharks?
We saw a little sand shark, but it wasn't very big, so it wasn't bad.
4 foot long.
4 foot long?
Yeah. Not very big.
What'd you do when you saw it?
We ran.
Tried to.
Swam fast as we could. Saw an eel, too.
What kind of an eel did you see?
I don't know. It scared me, too. This guy just got through telling us about him being biting you or something. I don't know what it was.
Mm-hmm. Oh, y'all got out of the water as soon as you saw the eel.
Yeah, we're out now.
Marcus, you and Lionel have been in snorkeling today. What did you get down there?
Well, we found this coral at the bottom of Hanama Bay today, and we stayed out about an hour, I'd say, and it's just a lot of animal life that you wouldn't believe I've never seen before.
Had you ever been snorkeling before, either one of you?
Not me, I never have. This is the best life I ever had going under the world.
Really?
Yes.
You liked it?
Right.
What about you?
Well, I've done a lot of snorkeling down in Daytona, and but this is my first time to Hawaii, and I just love it.
Well, one thing about it, it's raining now, and it's freezing standing out here in this rain, but it's not so bad in the water, is it?
No. I think the water temperature is about, I'd say, about 30 to 35 degrees. And it's not that cold.
What'd you say?
I believe I'd rather go back in right now.
Okay, Chuck, we have a interesting group of people here ready to go out doing a little bit of scuba diving. Have you given them all the proper instructions?
Yes, I have. And I've got them all prepared to take them out in one of the most beautiful bays here in Hawaii, and they're all ready to go. I think they ought to have a good time.
They understand all the proper precautions they should take.
Oh, yes. Very much so.
Are you sure you understand them all?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Mike, have you ever done anything like this before?
No, never in my life.
Why are you doing it now?
Because I'll never probably do it again.
What do you think it's going to be like out there?
I don't know. I have no idea. I just imagine it's going to be real nice.
Now, you're loaded down. Have you got everything you need?
Yep.
Really? Come on here, man. Let me ask you about your... look at this man here. Looks like he's been in the water all his life.
Not really. I've been swimming quite a while, though.
Are you excited about this?
Very much so. Can't
what
wait.
Do you think it's going to be like out there?
Very wet.
I talked to Tommy West and Steve Poole earlier, and they said while they were swimming around out there that they saw a few baby sharks.
Really?
Yeah, really?
Really? Oh, wow. I can't wait. Okay. Okay.
You still want to go?
Yeah. Definitely want to go. Right.
Do you still want to go?
Yep. No doubt about it.
Do you still want to go?
Sure thing.
Do you still want to go?
I'm thinking about it.
So there they are, UT's fearless men in orange, paddling off into the sunset.
I'm Pam Kirk, and I'm here supporting the UT Vols, and we're really having a good time.
Do you go to all the UT games?
Yes, I go to all I can, and I'm really enjoying this one especially.
Now, you all are kind of a rowdy bunch. I've heard you all already. Introduce yourself.
I'm Libby Murphy from Jackson, Tennessee.
Now, you're here for a very special reason.
Yeah, of course. My brother plays. He's John Murphy, number 83. I had to get
leave that in.
One other thing, we've got to get in. We can't leave this. Here we are out here. What kind of a milkshake is that you're drinking?
This is a very special milkshake. This is a banana.
A banana milkshake?
Yeah. Very good.
I'll tell you what, one thing about those milkshakes, they make you smile a lot, don't they?
That's right. This is very good.
What?
The second milkshake makes you smile. The first to get you going. Go
big on. All right, I want to start off with an interview with this group from Sumner County. And Mayor Kelly, I want to know, have some kind of a progress report on how things have been going the last couple of days.
I get, Hill. There's nothing to report in progress, but things started off fast and ending the same way.
About half of Sumner County's here.
It's just like home away from home. The next best thing to Gallatin I ever saw in my life in Sumner County. It really is.
And everybody's here to cheer on the Big Orange. Let's have a big go, Big Orange! Larry, what a great week here in Hawaii.
Man, I tell you, it's unbelievable here. It's so beautiful, and we just got through that nice-looking hula girl. And man, this place, I'd like to stay forever. It's great. I can't even describe it.
Did you ever think that someday you would be in Hawaii?
No, not even when I was a freshman, red-shirted, sophomore, any of that. I thought this day would never come, and I'll tell you, it's great. And everywhere you go, there's Tennessee people all over the place, 5,000 or 6,000 fans, and I don't know if the island can handle that all at once. It's great.
Now, you just finished doing the hula, and I wonder what kind of grades you'd give yourself on that.
I don't think they have blowing F, but I didn't do too good. I was too busy watching her, that's for sure. She was unreal.
Now, you have gone out and purchased you some items of interest since you've been here.
Yeah, this is what you call the tourist look, I believe. So I decided I'd be a real full-fledged tourist for one day. I don't think the natives even dress like this.
Are you going to wear any of this stuff after you get back to Tennessee?
Yeah, of course. I hope somebody comes up and asks me where I got it so I can say Hawaii.
Coach Battle, what a great week here in Hawaii.
Well, it's been a great experience for 96 players and some coaches that may not ever have had a chance to get over to Hawaii, and it really has. It's been a lot of fun. It's been a new experience. It's been a educational experience. You know, that's part of education, is learning about what goes on in our country, and this is our country, the 50th state, and it's been a thrill to be here.
And this really, for this entire week, has just kind of become an extension of Big Orange country with all these fans over here.
Well, you know, we walked into Aloha Stadium, and about half of the seats are painted orange, and one of the players mentioned it was nice for him to paint them orange since we were coming over here. But I do hope we've spread a little bit of the orange throughout the islands of Hawaii, and I know that our 6,000-some-odd fans that have been here have certainly done that, and so maybe we can come back one of these days.
Okay. Hill, I'm from Murfreesboro, and I don't think I'd ever thought about this for a million years. It's really great. You couldn't have done something like this if you hadn't been going to University of Tennessee and playing under a great man, Coach Battle.
What do you like the most about your trip so far? I know you spend half your time out here on the beach.
Golly. Well, the beach, of course, and the scenery is just unbelievable. You can't even describe it. You'd have to come and see it for yourself, I think.
One of the most interesting and inspiring parts of the trip, the day the entire team visited Pearl Harbor. We were there on December the 9th, only 2 days following the anniversary of the December 7th, 1941 attack on Pearl Harbor, and the visit left an impression on everyone. This has to be a good experience for these football players who are on this tour today.
No question about it. These young gentlemen are seeing one of the most unusual military establishments in the world, one of the finest naval bases, and one of our most historic points of interest.
One of the most common misconceptions about the Arizona is that the bomb she destroyed here was a single bomb, went on her main stack, flew up into boiler.
The high point of our visit to Pearl Harbor came as we approached the resting place of the USS Arizona. David, this has really been an interesting and a very moving day here at Pearl Harbor.
That's for sure. This being so close to the anniversary, December 7th and all, it's really meaningful just to come here.
Had you ever kind of visualized what it would be like to visit this place?
Well, yes, but you really don't get the feel of it till you really just come here. It's really something.
It's kind of an interesting and yet kind of a moving experience, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. You know, you see all these thousands of people with their name up on the wall who are, you know, here below you, and kind of gives you an eerie, ghostly feeling, you know, of how many people actually died here back then. And here it's kind of a party-type mood and everything, but then you start thinking about it, and it really sinks home how many people gave up a lot so you could be standing here with an American flag above you instead of a Japanese flag.
Dr. J. Julian, you thought you were going to get out of some work and come over here to Hawaii and watch a football game, but you ended up having to do some work after all.
Yes, I found myself at a band rehearsal yesterday at the University of Hawaii, but I smuggled in a copy of the Tennessee Waltz, and they're going to play it tonight. I'm going to conduct it, and they did a great job at the rehearsal.
Had they ever heard the Tennessee Waltz before? Did you hit them cold?
Oh, no, they've heard the number. They know it. I think it's known all over the world. It's a well-known tune, but they hadn't received this arrangement from our arranger back home.
So this is a special big orange version of the Tennessee Waltz.
Right. That's the one that we do every ball game at UT, but it's happy to be over here.
You're here with a whole bunch of people from Tennessee, and you've got a special sign out here on the side of the stadium.
That's right. We made it today. Cousin Joe here made it for us.
Cousin Joe, you're kind of the escort here in Hawaii for all of these people from Tennessee. What do your signs say?
My sign says, from the big orange, aloha, mele kalikumaka. It means Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
All right. Can you say big orange for us in Hawaiian?
Well, there's a lot of words that mean quite a lot, and big orange is something I'll have to get up and do.
You can't translate big orange in Hawaiian?
No, not at all, but I'm happy to say big orange mahalo and mele kalikimaka.
Okay, let's hear it from the big orange people here. Sorry.
Tennessee followed it up, and it just so happens my husband is stationed in the service here. He's a Marine.
In Hawaii.
In Hawaii. And they said they was coming over. My brother called me up on the telephone and said, Faye, you just gotta go. And here I am, big as life. I can't believe it.
You're a big orange fan, aren't you?
On the way. I'm just happy, can't you tell?
Where are you from?
I'm from Etowah, Tennessee. My mother is Mildred Walker, and we love you.
Why don't you say hello to Mildred?
Hi, Mom. Hi, Mildred. Hi, Peppy, Rita, Gay, Mama Bird, Anita, everybody.
And then it was game time, and what a game it was. The Hawaiian climate must have agreed with Stanley Morgan. He gained 201 yards rushing, a record for UT. Great game for the spectators. The new Aloha Stadium was filled, and Tennessee ended its season on a winning note. The final score, 28-6, and needless to say, the players were happy.
This is Tommy West from the winning Tennessee dressing room in Honolulu, Hawaii. We're here talking with three seniors, Tim Fitzpatrick, Ron McCartney, and David Page. Ronnie, this season's been a struggle so far, but we came out on a winning note. How about it?
Well, Tommy, you know, we had our ups and downs this year, and it's been a pretty long season at times, but we came over here to Hawaii, and we brought all our fans, and all the people came over here behind us, and the coaches stuck with us, and we've been fighting with our backs to the wall, and, you know, it pays off when you go out on a winning note, and it makes the whole season worthwhile, and it's been a great 4 years here at Tennessee.
It sure does make me feel good to see these boys excited. Well, that's what Big Orange represents. Good time and a big win, so I'm just happy for them to see them all whooped up like this. I'm just happy for them. And we can go back across the sea now and feel real good, real good.
From the ocean,
shining in the sun,
covering the shore,
when I see them,
my heart tells me that I love you more than all those little pearly shells.
Sound Hawaiian.
Boo, boo.
Among the birds and bees, you left me alone, but still you're my own in my beautiful memory.
Going back again, back to Tennessee.
love you, dear.
And I said, aloha.
1975 also saw the start of further expansion of Neyland Stadium with the completion of the South Stand's upper deck, which will add 10,000 seats to the stadium, so that Neyland Stadium, built with no tax dollars, will have over 82,000 seats, the largest stadium in the South.
1976 will feature an outstanding schedule. There will be 9 games played in the state of Tennessee, 7 at home in Neyland Stadium. The schedule will feature top teams from the Atlantic Coast Conference, the Southwest Conference, top independents, and our traditional Southeastern Conference foes. We believe that the people in Orange throughout the state of Tennessee will help to make 1976 a year that we can all remember with pride.
In 1975 for the Tennessee Volunteers, but there were things to remember about the season. Stanley Morgan, 201 yards rushing in the contest against Hawaii. And Larry Sievers did lead the SEC in receiving with 41 catches. And those who went on that trip will never forget their adventure in Hawaii. For this edition of Tennessee Football Classics Vintage Orange, I'm Bob Kessling.